Welcome everyone, I'm June, Iterative's content strategist, and I'll be the moderator for today. Of course, we have Hsu Ken, the managing partner of Iterative, who just played a Christmas song. He'll be speaking for the most part of this event.
And speaking with all of you.
Okay, Hsu Ken, you want to get started?
Sure.
Cool. Do you mind going to the next slide for me?
Yeah.
Thank you. All right, everyone, thank you again for making time. We really appreciate it. Before we start, I would like to take time to share more about Iterative. Now, Iterative was founded for founders by founders. Our mission is to increase the GDP of Southeast Asia through entrepreneurship. To do that, we need to, number one, make entrepreneurship more accessible to more people and give founders the tools and support to be successful. As part of this mission, we run events like this to help founders solve their biggest problems. Since Iterative started in March 2020, we've raised $65 million across two funds, invested in 100 plus companies and 200 plus founders. The Iterative companies have collectively raised over $168 million, and the total value of Iterative's company is now worth $1.2 billion. We are also now accepting applications for our Winter 2024 program. As always, there are no fees, and we invest upfront of up to $500,000. In the batch, founders will receive 3 months of targeted support from experts and visiting partners. If you are interested, we invite you to apply. Let me drop a link in the chat. This is only for event attendees only, and you can apply through that link. Let me quickly do that here. We'll also share more about how you can apply in the two-day program via our email. So we'll send an email to everyone and you can check out the link there. So here's the link. Cool. All right, so can mind going to the next slide for me? Thank you. Okay, here's how the event is going to go for the next hour or so. We have 25 participants who sign up. Let me drop the name list in the chat so that whoever that is presenting, you can see who's coming up next. Let me do that quickly. Oops. Okay, you guys see the list? If you don't see your name and you sign up, please let me know. But this is so you're aware of your placement throughout the event. Now, for the participants who signed up, a quick reminder, you have 1 minute to share your idea to Hsu Ken before he shares his validation ideas with you. We do recommend you to keep to the 1 minute. This is so that everyone has a chance to share their ideas live. And we'll try our best to get to everyone in the list. Now, if we do run out of time and there is a possibility that we might, don't worry, we'll get Hsu Ken to email you and help you out. For observers, if you have any questions, reactions, drop them in the chat. We love interactions and we're more than happy for you to join in as well. So if someone said, I don't see the list. It's in the chat.
It's in the chat.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Cool. I also see someone that says they didn't prepare anything. It's okay. You can just skip through it if you didn't. Cool. What's going to happen as well is Hsu Ken is going to navigate the slide. So if you see your name and your problem and solution slide, just unmute and then you can share your idea. Cool. I think we can get started.
Okay. Maybe I'll say kind of like one thing here, and I try to kind of say this whenever we've done this. My job is not to critique anybody's ideas. I'm going to basically act like I have no opinions on any ideas. That's not the point here. My job is to try to just come up with ways that people on the call and whoever's idea is that can validate that idea. So you're not going to get any kind of like, oh, this market is too small, or like, I don't know, there's a lot of competitors. Like, you're not going to get any of that. That's not the point of this. And so, no need to kind of like be shy about kind of like talking about it. Can you get the critique afterwards? Afterwards, I'll stick around. I can critique ideas. Okay.
Is there an Arshe here?
Hey, yes. Yes, I'm online.
Hi, Arshe. You can share your idea.
Sure. So the idea in brief is essentially to act as a bridge between the applicants when you have a job posting. Today there are various problems around many people applying and then very few resources to interview them. and the ATS systems are pretty much driven by keyword searches, and the searches are not great. So the idea was to make an AI which can do resume filtering and reach out to candidates, talk to them, and find out whether they are the relevant, you know, whether they have the relevant experience or not.
Yeah. Okay. And maybe I'll kind of ask a little bit of kind of follow-up questions. The screening agent, is that a person, or is that going to be a agent, or kind of like a...
It's going to be like an AI agent.
An AI agent. Okay. And they're going to message them through
email? They're going to reach out through email, yeah, and say, hey, this is like your introduction round, and they just want to dig deeper into the specific experience, which is of relevance, and understand how much they've really worked on it. And, you know, candidates exaggerate and sometimes lie as well on the resumes, which ends up being a big problem later on when the hiring manager talks to them.
Got it. Okay. I think there's two things that you could conceivably test here, because you actually got to get kind of work with two people. You got to work with the hiring managers and the companies that are trying to hire, and then your agent also has to be able to kind of reach out to people and get responses from them, right? So if the agent can't get anybody to respond or anything like that, then that's like not that useful. So I would do validation. I guess there's validation always has levels. So the first level is, I mean, I would just start reaching out to a bunch of HR and recruiters and that kind of stuff. You could do it on LinkedIn. You could just like search for them and then like cold outreach them. You could probably use lead list generators to find emails and guest emails of recruiters. You can do all that stuff. And I would basically like talk to them about what you're working on. And your email is basically how you kind of communicate that. And I would put it all in there and being, hey, we have this product. It does this thing. Do you want to use it or not? I think the thing that I would do that people are sometimes kind of afraid to do is I would tell them you already built it, and I would see if they want to sign up for it, and see how many of them will get on calls with you and how many of them will actually kind of like pay for it. There's the next level of validation, which is you're having AI screening agents reach out to candidates, but in the beginning, you don't have that much volume. So you should just be the screening agent, and basically act like an AI agent that, and they can kind of like, and see how that works for people and see how your customers kind of like it. So there is a version of this. The filtering is a little bit different, but the like screening agent is something that you could just like, you could just do it manually to kind of like figure it out. Again, the thing I often say on these calls is that software is only for scale. And in the beginning, you just don't have scale. So it kind of doesn't matter. So if I were you, I would try to sell to HRs, and then I would just like Wizard of Oz this, which is what I lovingly call telling people it's software, but it's actually you.
Sounds great. Awesome. Thank cool. you.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Arshay. Thank you, Hsu Ken. Move on to the next slide. Is there an Ali here? Ali? Okay, if not, we can just move on.
Okay.
For now. Is there...
Hello, hi.
Oh, hello.
Hello, hi. Yeah, going from your all day. Yeah.
Right. I was so afraid of mispronouncing your name.
Okay, I know it's hard. You can call me Ozek, by the way.
Okay.
Hey, man.
Okay. Yours.
All right. Okay, so we are building an incredibly easy-to-use financial dashboard and planning apps for startup and SME powered by AI, right? So I think most of the founders or business owners, they're lacking of the dashboard or metrics in business, and they are using Excel to manage their business, especially doing financial modeling and financial planning to understand their burn rate, everything. So what we are planning to, you know, the limitation of the Excel, right? Hard to collaborate, you know, complex formulas, create everything. So we are planning, we are building up an AI, like a predictive analytics linked to the cloud-based accounting. And then we take all those complex formula, simplify it, and put in a simple dashboard and forecast financial future. So that, and then the business owner also can create multiple scenario of financial analysis and then make it easy for them to use. That is the plans that we are.
Got it. It's a similar kind of thing as kind of the last one. And a lot of B2B ideas, you can kind of validate in the same way. Just start reaching out to business owners and like trying to sell your product to them, right? The one thing I would try to figure out if I'm validating this though, is what types of business owners need this more than others. So business owners, there's lots of business owners. Like technically I'm a business owner and the coffee shop that I just went to this morning is a business owner. So there's a lot, right? And they have very different needs. And so I think part of validation is figuring out if people want this, but it's also equally as much as who actually wants this. And so, again, rather than just being like, hey, just go reach out to people and try to sell it. The thing I would try to figure out is I would try to sell this to maybe 3 to 5 groups of people and see which one is easier to sell to. So is it easier to sell to SMEs? Is it easier to sell to, I don't know, manufacturers? Is it easy to sell to dirty venture capitalists like me? Like what is, like, which one is it? And then the pitch might be kind of like somewhat differently, but I would try to kind of like sell it. If you get anybody that's interested in it, you could actually fake your product too. And you can fake your product basically by having them, I don't know, give you their Excel or give you some sort of kind of like upload, and then you kind of organizing it for them. And it's a little bit trickier, but if you have like an engineer, you could basically fake the product and you could kind of like fill in all the information kind of for them. And so it's not like real time or anything like that, but like you basically took their Excel sheet and made it onto a web page and then like showed it to them, right? And so that's like the second level stuff if you can get anybody. But the first step is I would start talking to kind of different business owners about what their problems are and then how you potentially can sell this. And, you know, I would see if anybody's interested in kind of like buying it basically, right? So it's the same way. And maybe we can kind of send this out. I don't know if we have it somewhere, but you guys can automate LinkedIn outreach, by the way. And so the thing that I always did was I get a Sales Navigator account, which allows you to filter and search for types of businesses and how old and all this stuff. You can create a lead list on Sales Navigator, which is basically adding a bunch of profiles to some list. And then there are software available out there. LinkedIn technically doesn't like them very much. Don't tell them I told you to do this. But the software will pull the lead list and then automatically reach out to them for you through LinkedIn. And so that's a way that you can kind of do a lot of outreach. And a lot of our companies do sales that way. So that's like a pretty common thing. The tool that we use is called Meet Alfred. And so if you Google Meet Alfred, you'll see it. But that's a way that we kind of do it.
How to spell it?
Yeah. It's this. Just Google this. It's a tool that kind of comes up. It also gives you analytics on response rates and kind of like who responds, who accepts your connection, all of that stuff. And so we use that to test stuff quite a bit and we kind of see who responds the most. So, yeah.
Okay, understand.
All right.
Thanks.
Thanks.
Thank you. All right, Beatrice.
Hi. So the problem we're trying to solve is that in a lot of Southeast Asian countries, the retail landscape isn't as developed. So what that means is that first, either the items don't exist here, they only exist in the West. And second, they're way more expensive here. So what we wanted to do is a service that basically lets anyone become personal shoppers and gets these items for you from the West and then brings them back here. And we did try to sort of validate this by posting Instagram stories, asking if people were interested, as well as interviewing people who do offer this type of service on a manual basis. And one thing we found out is that it's a very niche market. Some people like ordering fresh egg tarts from Hong Kong. Some people like luxury bags from Japan, from Europe. So that's like really the market. But what we wanted to ask is more on what our platform should look like. Would it be better for us to be a peer-to-peer marketplace where people post this service and then they're like buyers? So very much like listings, or should we be a platform where users send in the item, the link to the item, and then we tap into our network and ask our network to look into it for them? So yeah.
Yeah. The honest answer is I have no idea. But here's how I would figure it out. I would try to do both. And what I mean by try to do both is you could conceivably make a listing so people can actually just like put listings on there about what they want, right? So you could just make a Google form or an Airtable form and it is like, hey, is there stuff that you guys want? Here's a thing, like we'll try to match you with somebody. And so you could do that, right? And if for no other reason, just to find out what do people actually kind of like want, and you could do that. And so you could make one version of the product. And by make, I mean, just make a Google form and then have a listing. And then when you get a, let's say you get 10 people to kind of fill this thing out, you could put that, make that list public, and then kind of also post and be like, hey, there are 10 people who want these things from these places. Here's how much they're willing to pay. Does anybody want to do it? So you don't have to write any software at all. You just like make listings that will populate this like spreadsheet or something, and then share the spreadsheet with as many people as possible and see what happens. Right. So that's one thing. So you could try that. That's pretty straightforward. You could be done with that by Monday, like setting that up. And then the other one, which is a service, actually it's the same thing, right? And I guess it's the same thing where one side of it, which is people want items from somewhere, is the same in both places. They just need to fill out this form. And so you could share that with other people to see if anybody else is willing to do it. But you could also then see if you can kind of like do it, right? And so actually one side of it is exactly the same in both places. And so maybe what I would try to figure out is who wants what from where and how many people want this. So try to get that side. And then the name of the game after that is just how do you make it happen for them? Do you need to do it? Do other people need to do it? And it's easier if other people can do it for you. So I would try that first. And then if you can't, you can kind of like try to kind of do it yourself, right? If you're going to actually do it yourself, I've heard this idea before. I've heard some people will actually do it, but they will limit where. So they'll only be like KL Singapore. We can get you stuff from KL, but it's only KL Singapore. And then they just buy a plane ticket to KL every week and they do it for them. And they buy everybody's thing, right? And that could be a way that you could actually start. And then you're basically just building out kind of more like routes. So it's like, okay, KL Singapore. Okay, now we're opening up Penang, Singapore, and then we're opening up Bangkok, like that kind of stuff. And so you could do it that way. But I think this is very demand driven. So I would try to figure out the demand side first, then figure out how to, does that make sense? Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you, Beatrice. Okay. Next up is Brian, and we have two Brians. This is the one with a Y.
Okay. That's me. Thank you.
Hi, Brian. Go ahead.
So problem is that when software teams are building during development, requirements always constantly change. And then people like the tech leads, PMs, BA, developers, they all come into one meeting to sort of just either discuss about something, but if someone don't come, then they sort of have to set up a separate meeting to do that knowledge transfer. And it's sort of pretty expensive because everyone's money is time and the company is essentially paying those people's salaries. The solution is sort of like a ChatGPT wrapper where any requirements change that we see on Slack or Google Meets will sort of be automatically updated to a single repo as a source of truth. So if anybody wants to get updated information or information that's only relevant to them, they can just simply ask questions about through that solution and then they can just receive the answers about that. For context, we just spoke to roughly around 30 users already, but then wanted to understand how we can MVP this thing before we even start coding. I think I'm muted, sorry.
By the way, validation, MVP, different things, right? And so I think for some of the people I've been talking to, like the previous one, I was trying to give them the MVP, which is basically just like Google Forms and stuff. But so MVP can be helpful in validation, but they're not like specifically kind of like the same thing. You can actually validate stuff without an MVP. So just to kind of make it kind of clear for everybody. Okay, a couple of ways that I would tackle this. You can obviously kind of reach out to people. You talked to 30 people already. Are they people that you knew? How did you find those 30 people?
People that me and my co-founders know.
Oh, okay, cool. So I would do, you can go, there's two paths you can take here. You still don't know if people want it yet because those are all people that you know, right? And so you can do the same thing that I was kind of suggesting to everybody else. You can kind of use LinkedIn, cold outreach, and all that kind of stuff to see if like people you don't know will get on the phone and talk to you about it. And then subsequently, you can also kind of like see if people will kind of like sign up for it and give you your email and all of that kind of stuff. So that's how I would validate to see if it's interesting. If you want to try an MVP of it, I don't know if there's a way to do an MVP without coding this one, right? Because it's kind of like you need all these integrations and all that stuff. I think the trick is going to be you're going to have to get really good at minimizing like the scope of the MVP. That's, I think, probably like the most important part. And so you just have to make it super narrow. So you're not, you don't have to just like build too much. Yeah, but I would validate first. I wouldn't touch the like MVP part, and still I'm like validating. I basically don't trust my friends anymore. My friends all tell me they use stuff and then I make it and then they don't use stuff. And so I don't trust my friends anymore. So I would definitely spend more time validating it than kind of like the MVP part. And if you can get some other people to kind of use it, okay, then maybe I would kind of like talk about it, but I wouldn't build it yet until you start kind of doing that.
Okay. Yeah. And also if you have some time after this to critique the idea, I would love to hear thoughts.
Cool. Yeah. I'll hang out for a little bit afterwards. I'll play some music. I'll critique ideas, make suggestions. Cool. Thanks, Brian.
Thank you, Brian. All right. Do we have a Carolyn here today? Okay, giving it 3 more seconds before we move on. Okay, let's move on. Casey? Is there a Casey here today? Don't think so. Let's move on. Chris. Do we have a Chris?
Yes. Yeah.
Hey, Chris, go ahead.
Yeah, sure. So basically, the problem is serious health issue often comes when detection is too late. So thinking about yourself, your annual health check once a year, or until a real health issue happens, and then you know you have a health issue, right? So when it really happens, there could be huge financial burden, and it also stresses the national health systems a lot. So the solution is to proactively monitor your health vital metrics, and have a AI to actually analyze those data on a long-term basis, to be able to kind of provide suggestion for next steps if it detects some abnormal trends, right? So some of those actions or call to actions can be schedule a teleconsult, maybe explore some supplements, vitamins, or start on a exercise regime or a diet, for example, right? So I think my question is, how do I kind of validate this idea, or even like what's the next steps?
Who do you think you're going to sell this to?
Like, it'll be like people like you and I, the consumers, right? The people who are kind of interested to be more proactive in their health management.
Okay. So I think the thing that you're going to want to validate is, as part of the validation, you're also going to want to figure out who needs this more, right? So right now you're like all consumers, but like 21 year old kids who are like super healthy probably like don't care about this.
That's right.
So for consumer stuff, so maybe I can kind of talk about this more broadly too. For B2B stuff, oftentimes doing cold outreach and kind of like LinkedIn and all that stuff is best because you're targeting companies. For consumer stuff like this, I like to do paid marketing, and you don't have to spend very much money. When I say paid marketing, I'm like, you can spend $50 a week and kind of figure this out. And paid marketing is helpful because it gives you demographic information, right? And sorry, paid marketing on social media platforms give you demographic information like the TikToks and Facebooks and Instagrams of the world. And so if I were you, I would make an ad on Instagram or Facebook that describes your product, has a picture of somebody being healthy or whatever, like all of this kind of stuff. And I would see how many people kind of like click on it. And you can look at click-through rates and impressions and all of that stuff. I would then also make a landing page to see if people would sign up for it. And you can just say, it's like coming soon. Here's the things that it does and all of this stuff. Right.
Yep.
And I would run that and see how many people kind of like sign up, see what the click-through rate, because you get this whole funnel, right? It's like, okay, how many people saw my ad? Okay. How many people clicked on the ad? Okay. How many people came to my website? Okay. How many people actually signed up for my thing? And you can see this whole funnel. The interesting thing about the ads though, is let's say that 1% of people who saw the ad clicked through, let's just say. What'll be interesting is in Facebook's ad manager, you can actually start dissecting who looked at the ad by age, by gender, by location, and all this kind of stuff. And I guarantee you will find that different groups click on it at different rates. So if you find that overall 1% of people click, people under 30, 0.1% of them click, and people over 60, 10% of them click. You're like, oh, okay, people over 60, like maybe that's my move, right? Maybe you find out people in Malaysia don't want to click, don't click on this. Maybe people in Singapore click on this. And you're like, okay, people over 60 in Singapore are kind of the thing. So you're starting to kind of like get a better feel for who is interested in your thing as part of validation. The other thing is, if you can actually get people to sign up for your thing, I would start emailing them also and like, see if you can talk to them, right? Be like, hey, I'm the founder of this company. We're developing this product for people like you. I would love to have like a 15-minute phone call to just like find out why you're interested and what you would like to get out of it, you know, so that we can make sure that we're building the right product for you. And so you're starting to build this whole feedback loop of like the numbers and the ads, and you can do calls and all of that kind of stuff. Based on having that information in those calls and those numbers with people, then I think you can start getting a better sense of like what this product actually kind of like is, because I can see from here, you have a lot of ideas that are a part of it, but I guarantee when you start talking to people, you're going to be like, oh, okay, people don't care about this stuff. They care about this thing. And so to help you kind of like shape it. So that's what I would do. I would set up this whole kind of like ads landing page, do that, start talking to people. I make June do this on our team. People that subscribe to our newsletter, she's just like getting on calls with them to find out why people are subscribing to our newsletter and what they want and all this stuff. So we're doing the same thing. So yeah.
Very good feedback. I think in summary, it's really to understand who are your target audience, your demographics. Yeah.
Yeah, and find out who kind of like wants it, right? If your click-through rate is 0.1%, like, okay, what's going on? Why don't people want this? I think people want this. So then you have to figure out like change how you talk about it, change your ad, new photo, you know, new kind of like copy, whatever it is. So yeah. All right. Thank you, Chris.
Thank you, Chris. All right, David. I don't think I saw David in the list, but giving it a few seconds before we move on.
David emailed me about this idea.
Oh, did he?
Yeah, he did. Yeah. Maybe. By the way, if we go past your name and then you're here later and you're like, oh man, they like missed me or whatever, just put it in the chat and we'll like circle back.
Cool. All right, let's move on then. Goku? I think I saw him. No, I was wrong. Goku? Okay, moving on to Rochelle.
Hi.
Hello. Hello. Oh, sorry. Oh, Goku, he couldn't unmute. It's okay, Goku. We'll come back to you later.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I'm actually working on this right now. So, but I wanted to hear your take on this. Sure. So the problem is that most small to mid-sized F&B suppliers in Singapore are still doing sales the traditional way. They're still knocking on doors. They're still processing orders manually, etc. And they really struggle with having an online presence and marketing online. So I just wanted to know how you validate this. With less than $1,000 because I'm working on this right now.
I feel like June, I feel like I'm just like such a broken record. I mean, we can summarize kind of all my advice is like, and what do you think your product is going to be?
This is going to be a B2B to C marketplace. So my aim is to automate everything. So you will, we will do the marketing for them. We'll do the sales for them. And then, it will, the platform will essentially be linked to their backend processing systems, their auto their accounting systems. Yep. So it eliminates a lot of the manual day-to-day tasks.
Got it. So I think that there's a couple of things that you're kind of like actually you're talking about with your product here. There's a part of it that is like, okay, you're trying to help them with online sales and marketing their business. And then you're talking about also efficiency, which are kind of two different things potentially, right?
Okay.
So if you want to tackle the marketplace, online sales, and all of that kind of stuff, you can actually just go to mid-sized F&B suppliers and be like, hey, I'm really good at this. You should let me help you. And then try to sell their stuff online for them, right? And kind of go figure out what works and all of that. First of all, see if you can convince these people to like let you do it for them, right? And you know, if you can't convince them, no product is going to like convince them, but see if you can convince them. And then if they say that they're willing to kind of like let you do it, then start doing the work for them. Even if you're kind of just doing it manually at first to kind of just like demonstrate and learn like how this is going to kind of work and that, and then you can turn for everybody on the call, I think a lot of the times when we're developing startups, we do a bunch of stuff manually and then we figure out what works and then we turn what we were doing manually into a product, right? And so I think that's what I would do here is like first try to see if you can kind of get people to agree to do this and then try to do it for them. And that's how I would kind of start. If you're doing it for them, they should pay you money, right?
Okay. Yeah.
So I would go to a mid-sized F&B supplier and be like, hey, I can do this for you. And you can give them some deal that they can like can't turn down and be like, hey, if I 2X your sales online, you've got to give me 10%. I don't know, whatever. Or you got to pay me $500. I don't know, something.
It's
right?
Actually like a marketing agency, the way you've described it.
At first, right? Yeah. At first.
Yeah.
Because then you got to figure out if what you're doing can be automated or not.
Okay.
Right? But you got to figure out what works first, I think is the like trick, right?
Thank you so much. It's actually kind of what I've already done. Thanks.
Are people paying you?
I'm getting commission. There's a commission-based sales. Yeah.
It's commission. Oh, so every sales you kind of do, then you kind of do it.
Sorry, again?
So every time you kind of like, you make a sale for them, then you get money.
Yeah.
Okay. I think then you're going to have to kind of figure out like, how I would then try to figure out then is the stuff you're doing, can you kind of turn it into a product or not?
Right? I've already done that. But I was just
what's your question? You already turned it into a product.
Hear, like if you had any like interesting ideas of validating this for less than $1,000 with a marketplace, with an MVP actually.
Well, sorry, but if you're a marketplace and marketing it online are not the same thing, right?
That's right.
So if you want to do a marketplace, then you have to kind of do the two-sided thing, right? Which is, okay, can you get businesses on your marketplace and then can you get consumers to buy from your marketplace, correct?
Mm-hmm.
That can just be a spreadsheet.
Okay.
You're just, a marketplace is just listing products.
That's right.
Effectively, right? So like it could be, I mean, the times that I've seen people kind of do this, what they basically do is they have a form where they get F&B suppliers to submit kind of what they would like to sell. That form kind of goes into kind of like some sort of spreadsheet or Airtable or database or whatever. Then they try to find, then they try to market, get consumers to look at that kind of like sheet. And then they make another form that is like, if you would like to buy something from this, WhatsApp me or fill out this form or whatever, right? And then they do pay now or whatever. And then they kind of send them the stuff. And so effectively that's mimics a marketplace, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I would try it that way. That's free.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you. All right. So mind going back to Gokul?
Yeah.
Thank you. Gokul, you want to try unmuting? Please unmute me.
I think you can just unmute yourself.
Yeah, because I can't do it from my end, Goku.
Yeah, nobody muted you.
Who's is not? Host is not allowing to unmute participants.
Okay, I don't know what that means.
Hold on.
Oh, okay, I just did it.
Okay.
I found the setting. Go ahead, Goku.
Goku, are you still having...
I just changed it.
He's not able to.
Okay, let's just go to the next person and then we can kind of like sort this out.
Yeah.
All right.
Cool. All right, Rawan, are you here? Don't think so. Let's move on. Vibhav, I think I saw you in this list.
if there's extra time, I would just help the people that are here.
Sure. All right. Yeah, I'll give you a call back. Hello.
Hey.
Hi. Sorry, I didn't figure out that. Yeah, I had to unmute myself. The problem is that renewable energy sources, if you look at solar panels or wind turbines, these are highly intermittent and many a times they lack reliability. So this is the story with wind and solar, at least. And if you look at specific property of these resources, the capacity factor. So solar generates for about, let's say, 4 hours or 8 hours a day. So that capacity factor is around 15%. Okay. So if you deploy, let's say, a solar panel of 1 megawatt, you would not get 24 megawatt hours of electricity. You would get something like 4 megawatt hours of electricity in a day. Okay. So the capacity factor is a bottleneck. And then you talk about the reliability. So the panels need maintenance, you need to clean them. Then there are days with overcast. And then if you talk about wind turbines, you can't really, I mean, weather prediction is...
I get renewables. You don't need to give me the primary renewables. What's the thing you're doing?
Yeah. So we are building energy generation systems, which are basically tidal turbines. It's like it. If you look at it, it looks like a wind turbine, but it's underwater.
Yep.
And the motion of water in the seas is very predictable.
Yeah.
So that's how we solve for the predictable bit. And these are modular turbines, which we can deploy in arrays.
Yep.
Right now we are doing pilots in canals and rivers. But the idea is to deploy these in offshore locations. Yeah.
Okay. Wait, you already deployed them?
So we have tried reaching out to some government agencies because ultimate ownership of river and these water bodies is with the government. So we have to go through the government and we're sort of trying to figure out the legal landscape here.
Wait, sorry. Have you deployed them or have you not deployed them?
We have tested one in a lab.
Okay. So you have a prototype in a lab,
yes,
right? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So these kinds of businesses are difficult, right? To kind of like test. You can't just like run ads and you can try to do kind of cold outreach and kind of like that kind of stuff, but it's tricky. But you can try to do it. But it's tricky. I mean, like how much does it cost for somebody to kind of put your, to buy your product?
So it's about, 50 to 60. So I have the numbers in rupees, Indian currency.
Yep.
50 to 60 rupees per watt, as opposed to solar that goes at 35 rupees.
No, sorry. How much does it cost to buy the entire machine?
So the machine, dimensions are built as per spec.
Yeah.
We don't have a, so I'll just give you an example. If we do so it's about 1 lakh rupees or 1 lakh rupees for 2 kilowatt.
Can you just give me a rough thing? Like what do you think is going to be the average cost of your product? Like, I know you're doing it to spec and all this kind of stuff, but just give me a ballpark.
So it's about 1/10 of a million for the 2 kilowatt unit. That is the price.
I know you keep giving me the efficiencies, but people are going to think about in terms of like capital expenditure initially. Okay. It doesn't matter. I think, $5,000 for a farm. Yeah. So, I think what you're going to want to basically do is, it sounds like you've been reaching out to kind of government agencies.
Yes.
Okay. I would start. And is there other types of people who want this product?
Yes. A couple of resorts which are located in coastal regions, which have access to water bodies within their land.
But is it only governments?
No, these are not governments. These are resorts.
Okay. It's kind of like what Sam is saying in the thing is like a lot of this is actually trying to figure out kind of like what do these people kind of care about and who wants something like this, right? And so I would start kind of like, I mean, if you're going to reach out to governments, I would continue to do that. Like there's governments, there's people that own resorts. Are there other types of businesses that might want this?
Whoever, like if you talk about mining industry, a lot of mines have water bodies located within their premises.
Yep.
So they might be interested.
Okay. So then what I would do is, I think you've got a fair bit of kind of like, this is validation. It's basically market validation, but is like, I feel like you have a product and a solution, and now you're trying to kind of go figure out who wants this thing. And you want to go figure out like, who should you talk to? Like, should you talk to miners? Should you talk to about the resort? Should you talk to like agencies? Like, they're all different types of people. And then even within those groups, who should you talk to in that group, right? Like, yeah. Is it like the finance person there? Is there like an energy person? Like at a resort, who is like kind of worried about kind of like energy? And so you need to start having a lot of these conversations and see what people are kind of most interested in. So what I would typically do here is for each of the, just pick groups that you're like identifying. So like government, mining, resorts, I don't know, whatever. There's like probably some set of them. Yeah. I would try to reach out to like, I don't know, 30 or 40 people in each of these groups. I would try to write a message that explains your product and why they should be interested in kind of like talking to you about it. I would send a message to all of those people, and then I would compare response rates. And so if nobody from the government reaches back to you, but half of the people from resorts reach to you, you'd be like, okay, cool. It seems like resorts are a little bit more interested in that. Let me go talk to them and kind of find out why they're interested in all of that kind of stuff. And so I would, I would do this search, but I would try to do it as structurally and kind of like thoughtfully as possible. So have the groups, send messages to kind of each of them, compare response rates, see what they kind of care about. And you're building this map of like, who wants my thing? For each of the people who do want the thing, what are the pain points I'm kind of like solving to them? What do they care about? Do they care about energy efficiency? Do they care about low cost? I don't know, whatever. And so I would start building out these kind of, we always call them personas, but basically like pain points for each of the customers and stuff. So I would start doing that work.
Yeah. One bit I didn't mention here was this was the hardware side of things, the turbine. And then there's a platform side of things, wherein we provide, so this asset class is much more lucrative from a financial point of view. So if someone wants to invest in renewables, this gives quicker ROI. So we're trying to aggregate in retail investors also, so that they could finance the deployment of these assets. And maybe they could fractionalize the ownership of these assets.
Got it.
So that is another side of thing we are trying to solve, but that comes at a later stage. I mean, am I right or wrong about this? If that comes later, this should come first.
That comes later, like 10 years later. I kind of feel like you're so early in this process. For everybody here, I think one of the things people do is they do a lot of what we call theory crafting. And what we mean by theory crafting is like, okay, this is going to work this way, and then this is going to work, and then this is going to work, and then this, and then this, and then this, and then I'm going to rule the world. And it's like, do the first thing first. Right. And so make sure that first thing for it works, and kind of like spend your time like worrying about that. Like the other stuff can kind of like come later. Unless the first thing doesn't work, then you can kind of switch up. But like, I have no idea what you're saying is going to work or not. Right. Like that's why validation matters. That's why you got to go talk to customers. Like that's the kind of like the trick. Right. But so I have no idea.
The reason why I thought of mentioning,
I'm sorry, we got to move on. I apologize. There's like other people on the list.
Sure. All right.
Yeah. Thank you. But if you have any more questions, feel free to email Hsu Ken. He will be more than happy to help you out. Sorry, before Hsu Ken, can we go back to spaces? Because we managed to help Goku unmute. One more. Goku, third time's the charm.
Yes.
We did it. Congratulations.
Yes, we did it. Yes, great. Okay, cool. So I'll start. One business idea most people would have thought at least once in their life is starting a restaurant or a food business. So what's the thought process behind it? People need to eat every day and their spending level is increased. So if I give them the right taste, my business is going to boom. But you know what? Most of the food business shut down, 60% of them in a year and 80% in the first 5 years. Food is just 10% of restaurant business, right? It's more of operation, people management and supply chain, because food business is completely labor oriented. So what we are doing, we are creating an automated restaurant where one person without any specific skill set can run the entire outlet. All he or she have to do is fill in the ingredients in the morning. The robot takes care of cooking, cleaning, packing, and sending out the food. We kept the engineering simple, no fancy robotic arms or hardware, simple engineering. So the entire machine just cost under $10,000, which can make Indian, Chinese, Mexican salads, pasta, soup, anything and everything that can be made in a wok, along with managing inventory, operation, analyzing the data, and providing personalized food. So when a person or wants to start their own outlet or want to take a franchise or want to expand their own food business, all they have to do is take our robot as a service or take our white label franchisee and start with their journey. So that is pretty much it. We have a good start for an year and recently raised a small check as pre-seed. And now we are planning to start our pilots.
This is not a pitch. You're not pitching me. Don't pitch me.
That's it. Just.
So what's your actual question? I mean, you're like raising money and all that kind of stuff already. What do you actually need help with?
So I just wanted to know, like, from over here, I want to get your opinion. How is it in Singapore, about automated restaurants? Because there's a lot of vending machines, but still food tech is at its beginning stages, but a lot of companies are growing. I want to know your opinion, where it's going, what's your thought on it?
I apologize. That's not what we're going to do here in this event. We're only talking about kind of how help people validate ideas. Email me if you want an opinion on that. You're more than welcome to email me, but I'm not talking about kind of like spaces and stuff here. I apologize. I want to talk about the things that people came to talk about. So email me if you want an opinion.
Yes, for sure. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Tizzy, are you here?
Yeah, I'm here.
Hi.
So,
hello.
Yeah, hello. Can you hear me? Yeah. So,
are you Malaysian?
Yeah, Malaysian.
Yeah, which part?
I live in KL, so.
Okay, June is from KL. All right, go ahead.
So, basically, what we know is that the healthcare system is no longer patient-focused as it currently is. Because if you imagine, like, you drive 30 minutes at 11 a.m. to a doctor's office for an appointment, you book a week before, with the clinic, right? And upon being there, you still have to wait 20 minutes on the line to get one appointment to the doctor. And when you reach there, there's like five people in front of you. So you have to like wait out after lunch as well. So imagine that ideal time that you can save. And basically we are that solution, right? We are a platform that facilitates convenient appointment booking for patients to reduce ideal time and pre-plan patients' schedule. So they can schedule an appointment ahead of time to a specific GP or a specialist. And the doctors within our ecosystem will be able to improve their visibility among potential patients nearby and diagnose the patient efficiently with our analytic solutions as well. And we validated this solution by talking to more than 30 doctors, and 29 out of the 30 would find this useful to them because, number one, it improves patient satisfaction, and which they agree is a relatable pain point for their patients as well. And number two is that minimize the risk of the clinic from being overcrowded. And number three is possibly reduce staff workload from manual registrations and appointments, and having them doing more, actually value adding stuff. Yeah. So that's basically our idea.
Okay. Surveys and that kind of stuff useful. The thing I always say is I never believe them. Like, people are like, oh, I would totally use this thing. I would immediately be like, okay, give me your credit card. And you'll find out how many people wouldn't actually kind of use the thing, right? And yep. So it's okay that you ask them. That's good, right? I think the next step is like, show me credit cards kind of stuff. Okay, I think there's a couple of ways that you can do this. And somebody else brought this up, but I've been thinking about it. And maybe it's a mixture. Maybe I'll give you a way to kind of validate, and I'll give you a way to kind of do an MVP. The validating is pretty straightforward. Guys, validating is basically just another way to do sales if you're kind of targeting kind of like clinics and other businesses and stuff, right? And so for you, this is like doing sales. And you got to figure out kind of like, start talking to clinics about this problem and trying to get them to kind of like buy your product and that kind of thing, right? And so if you are really not shy, which is what a lot of kind of like SF founders will do, they just start walking into clinics. Like, you can find all the clinics on Google Maps. They'll just spend weeks just like going to clinics and being like, hey, can I talk to somebody about kind of this? And they're trying to like sell to them, right? And so kind of trying to build up that list. And so you can do that. So actually, let me see if I can give you a bunch of ways to validate. So you can go to the clinics. You can try to kind of sell to them. You can call them. They might be kind of annoyed. So I don't know, you have to pick a like off-peak time, but call them, see if you can talk to somebody about it. Mm-hmm. Another thing you could do is you can use Google Keyword Planner Researcher, something like that. It's basically a tool that can kind of see search volumes on what people are searching for. I wonder if there's a reasonable amount of people that are searching for like doctor office appointment booking or something, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And if there is, you can actually buy Google ads and drive them to a website that you put together and see if people will sign up, right?
Yeah.
And then you can kind of, and then both is kind of good because one, you're getting kind of more qualitative feedback, and the other one, you're getting a little bit more quantitative to see if people search for something. it's always a really good sign when people are searching for something, because that means they're like independently by themselves being like, oh yeah, I really do need this thing. And then they're searching for that thing, right?
Yeah.
And so that's always a good sign to me. And doubly so if I find that a lot of people are searching for something and then I look at the first five results and they're all like horrible. I'm like, oh, okay, now I'm in business, right? And so I would take a look at those things. For an MVP, are you finding, if your guess was that most clinics are not using any software to do appointment booking, like if that was what you were finding out and you wanted to do an easy MVP just to solve that, like you wanted to give clinics a way to like book clinics that can organize and so their customers can make bookings online. I actually did this with one of our companies. It's called Beauty Buddy. They do this with salons. So they were trying to make an easier way for salons to take appointments because it was all WhatsApp. And I remember at the beginning of the batch, they were like, oh man, it's going to take us like 3 months to build an app. And I was like, cool, don't build an app. They just use Calendly. And what they basically, this is so funny. We were like, we're very pleased with ourselves when we did this. So they tried to convince beauty salons to use Calendly because Calendly basically is a calendar thing. And they didn't really want to do that. And they're like, I don't know. We get everything through WhatsApp. And so to prove it to salons, what they did was they started running Facebook and Google ads for the salon that drove people to a Calendly that they controlled. And then when somebody booked on Calendly, they would WhatsApp the salon and be like, okay, we got you a booking. Right. Mm-hmm. And then send them the Calendly view of being like, here are all the bookings. And then they would like enter it in. And after a while, the salon was just like, what is this thing screenshot you keep sending me? And I'm like, and you're like, these are all the bookings that are automatically happening. You like, I can give you this account. And the salon's like, oh, that's kind of cool. And then the thing that they found out was they were also trying to make a pitch to the salons that having online booking was going to increase their sales. And so they basically showed them, they're like, yeah, look, we ran these ads for you. And then we just did it to Calendly. And all you're doing is sitting around and getting bookings. And they're like, oh, okay, how do you do that? And then, so they use Calendly basically as their software. Now the company is like handled like 100,000 bookings now, and they have their own software. Mm-hmm. But in the beginning, it was like a good proof of concept to be like, do people want to book online in clinics or not? Because I think that's going to be something that Malaysia clinics are going to care about. They're like, do people want to book online? And you can prove it.
Yeah.
So you can you can prove it to them, right?
Mm. Okay. Thank you so much.
Go Malaysia.
All right. Tarun, hello. Go ahead.
So mostly growth marketers, really struggle with running growth experiments. So if we break it down into ideation, planning, and execution, ideation requires reading so many blogs and hours of research, and then planning, prioritization, and budgeting requires expertise. So a lot of seed to series A startups are struggling to find that PMF and want to run a lot of growth experiments. They struggle with all this stuff. So we are essentially fine-tuning an LLM with growth strategies specific to industries, and our AI can essentially help them with ideation and planning and also the execution eventually of some of the growth experiments.
Okay. Similar kind of like move here, like you can kind of make a landing page that explains all of this kind of stuff. You can do like outreach to growth marketing people. Like you can do all the stuff that I've basically said, right? So you can use that same playbook for this. Let's try to be like more
creative,
make it harder. Let's make it kind of more fun. Growth marketers are an existing community, right? And so like there is like, isn't there like a growthmarketer.com or something like that?
Growthhacker.com.
Okay, growthhacker.com. I think you can buy ads on it. And so you could conceivably kind of like make a landing page, buy ads and see if you get enough signups. I feel like there's also like Slack channels and Reddits and like all these other online communities for people who are kind of like working in growth. And I would start trying to be like talking to people and participating in those places to see, and again, drive them to your website to try to get signups. And so the way that I would set up your validation is have a landing page, explains everything that you want to do, have a signup form for it, and then try to drive traffic to it as much as possible. You can do it with ads, you can do it with kind of these communities, you can do it all this stuff and see what the signup and click-through rate is. For the signup form, which I actually think is kind of important, for the signup form, make sure you ask for more than just the email. Like ask for their LinkedIn profile, ask for what company they work at, ask for the size of company, ask for their title. And the reason why is you want to find out who is most likely to sign up for something. Like if you find out that like everybody that's signing up is like a growth associate, you're like, I wonder what that tells me. If what you're finding out is everybody is like head of growth at Series B companies, you're like, oh, okay. That's like a different target market. The head of growth at Series B companies probably wants something to like help organize. And they're like, oh, I got to manage this whole growth team. Like help me out with this. Whereas the associates are like trying to learn about growth, right? And so it kind of tells you different things. So I would set up the landing page. There's a bunch of different ways to kind of drive traffic at it. And then I would get signups. Make sure you get the information on kind of like what type of growth people they are. I would also then try to get on the phone with them and start talking to them about kind of like what the problems are and all of that kind of stuff. So you can kind of build this whole funnel, right? Of like doing it. Yeah.
Awesome. Thanks.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. Before we move on, I just want to let everyone know that yes, we know it's almost time. But Hsu Ken and I, we're just going to hang out past 7 p.m. But if you need to jump off, please. Let's stop you, please do. But we're just gonna keep going. So yeah. Is there an R share? I didn't see this person's name in chat, but let's give it a few seconds before we move on. Let's move on, Hsu Ken. Faizan?
Yes, hello.
Hi, go ahead.
So I'm Faizan. Living in Germany, I'm basically from Pakistan, and I'm working as a data analytics engineer full time, but building a product at the same time. From my experience of working as a data analyst and engineer and working with e-commerce stores down the road, I figured out that there is a need of a tool which could be simply easy for them to connect things from the Shopify, for example, and from the marketing thing and the operations things together. And have one dashboard as a source of truth where they can, of course, see the trends and kind of take the decisions to take the right steps in order to grow their business or increase their whatever. And particularly then taking it forward, then you can, of course, plan your future in terms of planning how much products that you are going to need in the next 6 months, given what was in the last 6 months, something like this. So the question here is that, what do you think? How should I validate this product?
Yeah.
Context, I have kind of created a MVP in terms of using open source tools, where I'm using existing BI tools, existing connectors and all of those things.
Yeah.
And then my own interface and bringing people to sign up and then doing everything manually behind the scenes and then giving it to them.
Yep. So, okay, I get it. For the interest of kind of speed, June, I think I can just read people's kind of thing and then like how to kind of like validate the thing. Fazan, I think this is very similar to Tarun's kind of like thing. There's tons of e-commerce founder communities that are out there. And so I would set up a landing page. I would go be part of all of those communities and talk to people about kind of like what you're working on and kind of drive them back to that. There's also probably a lot of e-commerce founder, e-commerce kind of like newsletters and events and all of that kind of stuff. And so I think you could probably, I don't know how much they cost. They're probably not that expensive. You could probably buy some ads in some of the newsletters and drive people to your landing page to see if people kind of like know about these things and kind of like see what the interest is. What else could you do? I wonder if there are ads within Shopify. You can
create an app just like an app store within Shopify, where you can. We have already built an app there, so people can go there and book, kind of sign up with our application and use this as an external BI tool for the Shopify store.
Got it. Yeah, then I would just do it. I mean, if you already have a tool and all that kind of stuff, you're like past the validation phase. You're just like trying to grow then. Then we're just talking about kind of growth strategies here. But so if you already have a kind of like a product, I think you're past the validation stage. You're just trying to grow. I think you can kind of like target a bunch of stuff. You could potentially kind of do Google ads too if people are searching for, you know.
Okay. And what do you recommend? Should I just target the globe, all of the e-commerce stores, because we're specifically focused on Shopify to start with, or how should we approach this? If you can give an idea of this.
I guess there's two ways to think about it. I mean, if you're thinking about Okay, if you're thinking about growing your existing product, then you can kind of target Shopify stuff. If you want to test potentially other platforms or kind of like other types of stores and other on other platforms, then you could kind of do a similar kind of like thing, but you can kind of open it up more. So I don't know, you're trying to test, what are you trying to test? Are you trying to test other platforms? You're just trying to grow your Shopify product?
Just trying to get some confidence that, okay, this is validated. I just feel that there is a kind of a question that comes to my mind. Okay, do they really need it? We have got some customers, but they were like, we got them from the agency perspective. Oh,
okay. Yeah. Okay. So for everybody kind of here, if you already kind of built the product and stuff, you're kind of past the validation phase, at least in my definition of it. And there's no kind of like core definition for validation, but you're past it to me. So the thing that you're trying to figure out is like, should you keep working on this thing or not? Because you already kind of have it out. And at least what we do during the batch is, can you kind of grow your revenue? I'm sure you're charging for this. Can you grow your revenue 5-7% every week, non-cumulative, right? So if you made $100 this week, you need to make $107 the next week, and then you need to make whatever the number is there. But can you keep that up or not, right? And if you can't, then it might be a smaller thing than you think about. But if you can, then it might be kind of like a bigger thing. And so after you built a product, then you automatically go into kind of growth mode, and can you keep your growth up is kind of like our thing. So that's how we think about it. And if you are trying to figure out whether your product is, okay, sorry. If you're trying to figure out whether people want your product, it's basically growth. If you're trying to figure out if people are satisfied with your product, it's retention. So if people are using your product and they are churning, like they stop using it, they don't like your product, right? Okay. Obviously they would keep using it if they liked it, right? So, you can almost think about it as like people are signing up for your thing because they think they want your product. And then if they're actually using it and they don't continue to use it, then they're basically figuring it out that they're like, oh, this is not actually that useful. And it could be that, you know, your product doesn't deliver on what they were kind of hoping for or like whatever. Right. So I won't do a whole retention kind of like thing here, but if you are trying to dig into retention and trying to understand retention, look up cohort analysis, retention cohort analysis. That is the gold standard for like how to kind of figure this stuff out. So yeah. All right. Next one.
Thank you, Faizan. All right. Flair, I think she's here. But Hsu Ken. Okay, so in the interest of time,
Hsu Ken,
you're just gonna react. And then, but if you have any questions, feel free to unmute and ask.
Okay. AI brand content co-strategist to create a content plan for your brand in less than 2 minutes. Okay. This I think is pretty straightforward, but it depends on kind of like who you're trying to kind of like target. So there's lots of different people who kind of want brands and want content strategists and all of that kind of stuff. And so I think if you're selling to companies and people at companies, I would kind of do all the normal kind of like LinkedIn outreach, all of that kind of stuff, landing page, try to get people to buy the product. You can do all that stuff. So June, we should just get a name for like whatever that is, because I feel like that's just like the thing we can like use everywhere. So I would do that. The thing that you would want to figure out here is what types of companies should you be selling to? So is it like tech companies? Is it like SMEs? Is it like whoever? Who at the company should you sell to? So is it like the CEO? Is there an existing content person that you're selling to? Or is it a company that like they don't have any content people yet? Like, who at the company, what stage, all of that kind of stuff. And then the third thing you need to figure out is what is the value proposition? Like, what do they care about? And so, you know, create a content plan in less than 2 minutes is good, but is it because people are trying to like, they're trying to save money? Are they trying to save time? Or like, what is it? And basically, if you're selling to companies, it's always around kind of like, how do you help them kind of make more money? And you can help them make more money by increasing sales or decreasing cost or saving them time. Those are the only three ways. And so you want to get a good idea of like what that is. And so, yeah, I would test it that way, but most of the validation is kind of like trying to figure out who wants this thing.
Cool. Flair, I see you're here.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Hsu Ken.
Thank you.
That's pretty straightforward. I love it. Thank you.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you, Flair. We can skip Justin because I don't think he's here.
Okay.
But I believe Linda is here. So you can, Hsu Ken, you can.
Okay.
Hi, June. Hi, Hsu Ken.
Hello.
Hi, Linda.
So I'll just listen to save time.
Yeah. Okay. Coachable marketplace platform for coaches, entrepreneurs. Oh, okay. So it's like it's a coaching platform.
Yes.
And you're connecting people with coaches.
Yes.
Oh, okay, cool. Okay. Here's, I'll give you the validation and then the MVP. So the validation is you basically have a two-sided marketplace and you want to be able to validate both sides. And what you end up finding out is one side is harder or easier than the other to kind of like grow. And so, but you need to make, in order for the marketplace to work, you need both sides. And so I would make one landing page that is specifically for people who are looking for coaches and then try to get people to sign up for that. And then I would make another landing page specifically for coaches who are interested in being on the platform. And then I would try to drive signups to both of those sides. So, and you can do that in a kind of, I guess, a couple of the ways, like I'm sure people are Googling for coaches. So you can kind of do that. There's a lot of coaching newsletters and groups and that kind of stuff too. So I would just target anybody that's like looking for coaches and then drive them to your sign up. I think there's like coaches I feel like are pretty available on the internet. Like if you just looked up coaches in whatever country you're in, I'm sure a bunch of people will come up and you can just start cold emailing them and be like, hey, I'm putting together this platform. Basically, do you kind of like want extra kind of clients or not? And trying to convince them to kind of do this. Yeah, finding coaches, I think, is actually straightforward. Convincing them might be a separate thing. Okay, the MVP here that I would do is once you get some people that are signed up, you don't actually need very many coaches because you don't have that much scale. So even if you had like a handful of coaches who signed up, I would then just try to get them like clients basically by signing up kind of through your thing. And then you can kind of just, it kind of works after that, right? I guess at some point you can kind of build tools to do scheduling and all that kind of stuff. But at the beginning, you're just kind of matchmaking for the most part. And matchmaking can happen basically kind of like on its own. I guess there's flavors of platform where maybe the consumers can choose which coach and all of that kind of stuff. But again, you can kind of like put that all together and like, I don't know, even like a Notion document and just being like, okay, here are the available coaches. You can like choose one and we'll kind of like set it up. So I think it's like pretty straightforward way to kind of build an MVP for like not very much money. Yeah. But it looks like you have a website already.
Yeah. So I challenged myself to build it in a very short amount of time.
Good.
I guess the reason why I'm here tonight is to validate the end user side. So with the coaches, it's easier because they all want more business.
Yeah, of course.
But the end users, because usually to assign a coach, they kind of like go through a journey where the coach trying to warm them up, you know, before they sign up. And that's where the challenge is. That's where I want to validate. Like, how do you validate that?
Sorry, what did you want to validate?
So you know, like normally if you're a coach, right, you would write lots of blogs, which is what I was thinking that we would do on their behalf, right? Yep. But because I want it to be a marketplace for all kinds of coaches, not just relationship, not just health and fitness, but business and everything. And so then, so say for example, if you're a business coach, you would write blogs and stuff, and the potential clients get the chance to warm up with you. Oh. Before they finally say, oh, I'm going to sign up with Ken because I know. Yeah. So that's the challenge. That's where I want to validate before I go further, before I spend more time and energy and go further. Like with a marketplace. Sorry.
But I don't know if that's the right problem. Right. So, and again, I don't know. You're actually working on this and I'm not, but like, the thing that you're trying to figure out is if you're getting coaches and that's easy, the thing you're trying to solve for is how do I get bookings on my platform? Right.
That's right. I think, yes. The end users is the challenge.
Yeah. And I think you're assuming that it's like this warm-up thing, right? Which it could be, right? I have no idea, but it also could not be. Right. And so the thing I would be really focused on is how do I drive bookings to my platform? And having this warm-up thing is one possible solution. But there are like many other possible solutions, right? So like, for example, like, I don't know who Sam is. Sam has good suggestions. People should ask Sam questions. But the thing I was thinking about is like, there is a lot of different types of coaches. And so you could actually make what I was thinking about as kind of like category landing pages or kind of like, but they're landing pages for specific niches. So like have one just for relationships and have one just for kind of like business coaching and have one for another one and like see if that organization or kind of that framing helps people. You could try the content piece of this, where maybe you work with one coach and you actually help them develop some content. And if you see that that coach, their bookings on your platform like skyrocket, then you know that that might be effective for coaches and you can do it with more coaches, right? So if you really do think it's this, I would start small. I would pick one of the coaches. I would start working with them and see if you can kind of develop it that way before you kind of like do it with everybody. It's going to take a bunch of work and that kind of stuff.
Cool. Thanks so much.
Yeah. Good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you, Linda. All right, so we only have two more. It's Noor and Remus. So this one is Noor's.
Hey guys, thank you. Hsu Ken.
Hello.
I'm Noor from Bangladesh, and what I see that there is currently no B2B solution for connecting SMEs, restaurants, hospitals, even management companies with wholesalers directly. We are making an app which is Movers, which will connect with wholesalers, and wholesalers can just sell their products through us, and we are providing a logistic solution and the payment security system. So the restaurant owners get fresh needs daily, and the wholesalers can increase their sales through our app.
Yep, I get it. Okay, this is basically a two-sided marketplace. So same rules apply for all two-sided marketplaces, right? You got to win both sides. And so you got to figure a way to convince wholesalers to be on your platform. And then you got to go convince people that buy from wholesalers to be on your platform. What I would probably do first is I think wholesalers is probably like Linda's kind of like coaches. You probably only need a couple wholesalers first. And then I would try to go like basically get those wholesaler sales through restaurants, like cafes, hospital. Oh, hospital is an odd one in there. So I would do that. And then you can take orders. You basically go to the wholesalers, get what their catalogs are, go to the like restaurants, cafes, and hospitals and being like, hey, do you guys want any of these things? They order through you. You take care of all the delivery for them and then kind of just send it. And then that's fundamentally kind of how it works. And again, at some point, your catalog will just get bigger as you add more wholesalers, and then you can use technology to kind of do that. And then you do self-serve ordering and all of that kind of stuff. But like, you can just do the whole thing manually right now. I'll say this for some people that are working on these kinds of things. You might lose money on doing the delivery for people right now, but that's actually okay as long as it's not going to like, I don't know, put you in debt or something. But like, it's actually okay because you just need to find out whether people... you can kind of like help people sell their products. And so if you're just like breaking even or losing a little bit of money to do transactions, it's fine. You're just kind of like trying to figure it out. So I would do it that way.
Thank you for the validation.
All right.
All right. Moving on, skip this one. All right, Remus, this is the last one for today. Remus, are you here?
Yeah, I'm here. Is Hsu Ken going to retreat or do you want me to do a quick brief about it?
Let me read it real quick.
All right, thank you.
And then take an institution for live and 10 minutes.
I'm on speaker.
Yeah.
Remus, I muted you because I think you're on. Okay. Feel free to unmute yourself if you want to talk. End-to-end ticketing solution for live and 10 minutes. Ticking scam rates down to zero. Okay, got it. I think the thing that you want to figure out is how much do people care about scams, right? Because there's existing kind of ticketing solutions. So your whole thing is basically built on like, we are like the trusted thing. You won't get scammed and all of that kind of stuff. Okay. Interesting. There's a couple of ways that you can kind of like do this. That would actually be fun. This might cost you some money, but it might take a while. Okay, the idea that I keep coming back to is I would put up like a website or something, and I would put up a website, maybe just like a landing page, and you're trying to figure out, it's again, actually a two-sided marketplace, because you're trying to figure out I'm guessing this is secondhand sell tickets. So I'm just going
to assume. Maybe just to help you ease your thoughts process a bit. So we actually have a secondary ticket marketplace set up that do provide a KYC with our sellers and ensure that buyers get a full refund if the tickets are discovered as scam. And now what we're looking to explore further is our fairness system and to venture towards retail ticketing itself. So that's what we wanted to explore.
What are you validating?
We want to validate on the fairness system provide on the retail ticketing side.
What does it mean to validate the fairness system?
So just for context, right now concert tickets are being in Singapore is sold by Ticketmaster.
I get scam rates and I get fairness. I get that. Like what are you trying to validate about it? Like what is?
Want to see should it be as a subscription service to let Ticketmaster Assistant use our software, or should we be the sole provider of it and get other organizers to come and work with us instead?
Okay, this is not really validation as we're kind of like defining it. This is like a business model decision, right? This is a business model decision. And so it's not really kind of like validating an idea, and like, cause you already kind of have it up going and stuff. And so, look, to try to be helpful, I think the thing that I would kind of like try to figure out is just like, which one do you think is kind of a bigger opportunity? And what are like, I would just do the like scenario analysis. So if you do this, if you go down this road by yourself, how big do you think the opportunity is going to be? How much is it going to cost? What are you going to need to do in order to be successful? How do you kind of like win? And then if you kind of work with everybody else, what kind of company are you going to be? How much of an opportunity is that going to be? And like all of that kind of stuff. And then you can kind of like make your choice from there. If you want to get better information on whether you should try to do this on yourself, then I think you would try to figure out like how valuable the software is to kind of consumers. And so I would start maybe like, I don't know, like see if you start talking about how you have no scams and you have zero rates or whatever. If you have an existing marketplace for this, I would start seeing how much, if you start marketing yourselves as that way, how much the conversion rate would go up. Because if people don't really care about this, then like it doesn't matter that much. So that's the thing I would kind of probably figure out if you're trying to validate is like how valuable is this like ticket scam system thing. And if you already have a marketplace, you can just test it in that marketplace. Because if it is value, it should increase your conversion rates quite a lot. And then you can kind of like look at it that way. But it's a weird test because if it's not that valuable, Ticketmaster is not going to want it anyway. So I don't know. It's not really going to like help you choose which one you should kind of like do. So I don't know. Tricky.
Okay, understood. Thank you so much. Because I think one of the entrepreneur investors also did help reply to that as well. I think it was Domenico or something like that. I was speaking to him recently as well. So yeah, I do appreciate the comments and the thoughts as well, Hsu Ken.
What's an entrepreneur in residence? People always talk about these like that like term, and I've always been like, it's a well-known thing. It's not like a unique thing, but I'm always like, what is that? Like, what is that job?
He like a partner at Iterative right now.
Who?
Yeah, Domenico, I think.
No, he's a venture partner. He doesn't work for us full time. He went through our program and he kind of did that kind of stuff. But he's not an EIR. We don't have an EIR. But yeah, he helps talk to companies for us.
All right. Thank you so much for your time, Hsu Ken.
Cool. Yeah. Good luck.
Thank you. Hsu Ken, that's it.